All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm still here hanging out in Southwest Florida here. I'm here in Fort Myers, and today I'm at a university. It's really cool. It's the Florida Gulf Coast University. That's FGCU. You can kind of see it over on that side. And why I came to this campus today is to share with you guys the food forest at this campus. And you know, this is the first food forest at any kind of college that I've been at. And number two, it's probably the oldest food forest at any university in the United States of America. And I think this is actually really sad. I think every university, every college in America should have a food forest so that we could educate, you know, the students about where food comes from. You know, the longer we go on and on without educating people about the food system, about the problems of the food system, you know, the more we're creating food deserts, the more we're creating obesity, the more we're creating and having a need for a healthcare system, because people are separated from food and where it really comes from. So I'm glad at this university, they're taking the more sustainable approach. You know, they have like, you know, arrays of solar panels to, you know, solar power some of the different buildings and dormitories here. They also have like a, you know, basically a wildlife area here on campus. It's a really green campus. It's really cool. And they have LEED certified buildings and all this kind of stuff. Like, it's amazing. But the best thing I think about this campus is the food forest. And the cool thing about the food forest here is that it's not under administrator rule, because when administrators and red tape gets involved, I think things can get awry. It's basically run by the students and a student organization, so it's kind of kept separate. And I think this is the best way to have a food forest so that, you know, things and companies and sponsors don't get involved. So it's really funded by the students that come here, you know. And I think there's about 15,000 students that attend approximately this university. And you know, I was talking to some of the people that actually work at the food forest. They're like, they have on campus jobs, and some of this, there's like 7 students that get paid to work here a certain hours a week part-time. And if you're one of the students, you want to apply for that, because it's definitely be one of the easiest on-campus jobs, not easiest, but maybe funnest, because you could be pruning, planting foods, harvesting foods, teaching people about food and how to grow food instead of sitting in an office all day, right? So as much as there's some students here working at the food forest, I think it's really sad that most of the 15,000 students aren't taking advantage of the food forest that's here on campus. You know, if you're a student here, you gotta pay your tuition fees, you know, whatever per credit, you gotta pay the money, whether you're an in-state or out-of-state person. And your money, your student funds go to help pay for this food forest. And as a student here, you could actually come and harvest from the food forest. They're growing, the workers here are growing food for the students here. But unfortunately, only a small percentage of the students actually take advantage of this resource, you know, that's available to them, which I think is sad, you know. I mean, if I was going to this school nowadays, I would come here like all the time and like see what ripe fruits, whether that's jackfruits or Java Takaba, or you know, whether it's kind of different leafy greens that are available year round, or different herbs and spices, or you can make teas, or just you know, all the different kinds of food that's growing. People could come here if you're a student and harvest the stuff. Now, if you guys are not a student, right, this is also a public resource for you guys. So, you know, if you are in the local area or driving by the local area, you could actually stop by during standard daylight hours, like maybe 8 to 5 or so. It's open, you could just come wander around, but please be respectful of this place, because it is funded for by the students and actually grown for the students. But it is also here to educate the public at large of what can be grown here in Southwest Florida. As you guys can see, well, behind this big storage shed, they got all kinds of fruits and vegetables that I'll be sharing with you guys in just a few minutes. Now, the other thing you guys could do, if you're not familiar with a lot of the different plants and things that are in the food forest, they do have some signage. It's not like maybe the best signed, you know, food forest I've been to, but it has a lot of signs, which is good. They do also offer tours, and I'll put a link down below to an email address you could actually email to set up for your own tour of the food forest that they give on a regular basis. And then you could come in here and they'll give you like an hour tour for free, actually, one of the students will give you an hour tour for free so you guys could learn about the different fruits and vegetables and, more importantly, some of the perennial plants that I want you guys to be growing at home so you guys could feed you and your families. And if you guys are watching this and interested in, you know, some kind of degree in all this kind of stuff, you know, and you're of college age, or even if you're out of college, you want to go back to college, right? You could come to Florida Gulf Coast University and get an environmental studies major, and then you could take and work in the food forest for your volunteer hours, because every student here is required to do volunteer hours, and you could choose to do those hours in the food forest. So that's great. And hopefully, pretty soon they're going to have maybe a minor in permaculture. And you could, of course, if you come to the university here, you could get a permaculture design. You could take a permaculture design course as part of your curriculum, which is amazing. So, you know, this is probably one of the best places that to go for, you know, learning about permaculture, because unlike many land-grant universities that you may learn agriculture, right? A lot of those universities are getting paid off by big corporations to teach a certain curriculum, to teach things a certain way, to teach things maybe the chemical way, and you're not going to learn really how to do it the more natural way. And I like that at this university, you know, it's not like sponsored by all these corporations. It's like kind of like more mellow, and the people here, the students here that I met, man, they're just really down to earth and chill, cool people. So anyways, with that, what I want to do next for you guys is actually head over to the food forest and show you guys some of the practices they do and some of the plants that are really thriving in this environment, you know, and also encourage you guys to get out here to see it. I'm not going to be able to show you guys everything in this short video that I'm going to share with you guys today, but I thought I'd show you guys a couple things that will be really valuable to you guys, no matter where you live, whether you're here in South Florida or not. So before even going into the food forest, I want to share with you guys just maybe some of the things that they've done around the food forest. The food forest is approximately a half acre, and it's all fenced in, and so within that half acre of paradise, the students get to do whatever they want, and the administrators, they rule the area outside the fence. So it's a constant battle sometimes, you know, that administrators don't want things escaping out of the food forest to mess up all the native habitat and all this stuff, and it looks like to me they've done a good job to contain all the food forest stuff inside the food forest. Now, outside the food forest here, it looks like they got really a nice windbreak. And especially no matter where you live, whether you're on a, you know, parcel like this, which actually used to be a gravel parking lot, and I was glad that in 2011, they actually converted from a parking lot, and some of the students at that time got money, actually over $100,000 in 2011, to actually make this food forest happen. And since then, it's been run by the students here. But they got a nice big windbreak, and this is a good thing to have in, you know, a field like this, which it was, or at your home, you know, to prevent some of the climatic conditions like the weather, the inclement weather, you know, lots of winds, and especially, you know, the cold when it comes, it can help, you know, shelter your delicate fruit trees, especially some of the tropicals and more ultra tropicals that they're growing here, from the weather. When this area was a parking lot, what they brought in first was compost, which they have a small pile here, but because we're in South Florida, it's pretty much like sand. I mean, this is just sand if I just started digging underneath. So they brought in a lot of organic matter, so that's very important. They set up this food forest properly, and because they brought in all this compost in the beginning and now they're growing all these trees, they rarely bring in compost, maybe some compost here and there to start plant starts and whatnot, but this system is self-sustaining system because all the trees are pulling up nutrients from the original compost that got brought in. They make the leaves, and then basically the trees and everything, they drop the leaves, you know, in windstorms, papaya trees may fall, and they just stay in place, and then they basically compost and break down to basically keep all the nutrients cycling in the system. In addition, one of the sustainability things they're doing here is they got a nice big pile of mulch, and this pile of mulch didn't come from the local area. It actually came here from the school grounds. So the, you know, the landscape people on the school grounds actually trim trees and all this kind of stuff, and then they basically bring the mulch here to use in the food forest to basically feed the forest floor and to feed all the microbes and the bacteria and the fungi in the forest floor to create more nutrition for all the amazing plants inside. So if you come to the food forest, there's like a little welcome to the food forest with a little display and sign that'll tell you some information about some of the Florida tropical fruit, about permaculture and all this kind of stuff. The other thing that they have that's really cool is for the students that are students here, you could come to a sustainable harvesting class. As I said before, any student here could come to the food forest and harvest their dinner if they wanted to, harvest fruits. But in order to do that, you need to know how to harvest things properly, because you could really destroy certain plants if they're not harvested properly. So they have everybody go through the sustainable harvesting class so that they learn how to harvest properly before coming and actually ravaging this garden that's available for everybody, all the students here. So let's go ahead and go beyond the little doors here and share with you guys the half acre inside the food forest. All right, so upon walking in to the food forest, you guys probably can't notice this on the camera because the camera's like two-dimensional or one-dimensional, and I'm like three-dimensional hopefully. But you could see here, different areas of the food forest are at different levels. So like, as we walk in, I'm kind of like sloping down. And this food forest was designed particularly to basically channel the water to where they need it. So like, some of the higher ground may not get as much water and may not may drain the water, so like they could plant things on the higher ground that maybe doesn't like to have its feet wet, because some plants they'll get root rot if the feet's wet. And then they've actually slanted the ground so the water runs and they direct the water to a certain area. So as I'm walking in here, actually I'm walking down, and I mean, if we go to the back of the garden, which I may or may not show you guys later, for example, the bananas are at one of the low points where it collects a lot of the water, where it could be wet there. And some of the plants in that area really like the wet conditions. They've grown vegetables and other herbs that maybe like it more moist. And this is basically just creating different kind of microclimates. You know, that microclimate tends to be wetter, and if you plant it under the shade of banana trees, then it also may be shadier. And once again, in your home, you could have microclimates, right where your gutters run down. And if you're not collecting your rainwater, in the rainy season, that's where it's always going to be wet. So I like to plant water-loving plants at that point, right? And in places where it's like dry, maybe right under the eaves of your house that doesn't get a lot of water, you could plant things that maybe don't like as much water. So yeah, I want to always encourage you guys to make microclimates. And this food forest looks like it had a really good design when they built it. And even till today, you could see like really how well a food forest thrives is based on the original design. And I could see that this food forest is thriving fairly well. Another thing I like that they did is actually they put this grid down. Now this grid originally went down to make this ADA compliant, so that people in wheelchairs and whatnot could come through here. The grid's all underneath. And it's kind of cool. I don't know that I'd actually do that at my house. I'd probably just layer down a bunch of mulch and stuff to cover the ground. But nonetheless, it also demarcates paths so that people are not walking. They also have wood laying down that people are not walking on the beds. You don't want to try to walk on the soil. It compresses the soil and it's not good. Another thing they do here is they don't do tilling. They don't got no rotor tillers here. They got all these hand tools in the shed because they do not want to disturb the soil. One of the main principles that they're doing here is building the soil fertility. And as I mentioned before, they brought in the compost originally, and then also they bring in the mulch that you guys could see. But also, the trees are producing their own mulch. All the leaves are dropping, and different tree branches are coming in and they're breaking down. Now, aside from breaking down in place, they also have a compost pile as well as worm bins. But I want to always encourage you guys, if you guys have the space available and have a lot of space like they have here, just to let everything rest in place. It's also a lot less work to do that. And as to worm bins, I think worm bins are an excellent vehicle because they do a lot of education of kids and different things here. It's a good vehicle to teach kids about worms, but the best place for worms, in my opinion, is actually just in your ground. And if you're providing a nice environment and home for them, including a lot of the organic matter and a good moisture level, the worms are going to thrive underneath the ground where they really need to be, where they really need to be making their worm castings right in place where the tree needs them, like right in the root zone. So yeah, I mean, let's go ahead on a tour and share with you guys just maybe some of the cool plants. I really want to focus on maybe some of the plants that may serve you guys better if you guys live in the area. I mean, I could show you guys all kinds of cool jackfruits and Meyer lemons and papayas and all this stuff. But I think where I want to start first is with some of the edible perennial leafy green vegetables that are gonna do fabulous in this climate, because those are what, you know, if you were a student here, coming here, those are the things that are gonna be in season and growing year round that you could always come and eat. If I showed you guys fruit trees may produce fruit once a year, you know, some produce fruit year round like bananas and papayas. Those won't be as useful, but I wanna encourage you guys to grow things that are gonna be the most useful for you. And the greens, they have the most nutrients, least amount of calories, as well as they grow year round and they'll really sustain you. And then finally, I'm gonna focus on maybe some of the fruit trees that I think are a little bit more beneficial than the others. So at the end of this episode, I wanna interview Cam, the president of the food forest here. And he's also a student, transfer student, and ask him more about the university as well as the food forest. Anyways, let's come along in this journey and show you guys the first edible perennial leafy green I think you guys should be growing. So the first tree I wanna introduce you guys to is this guy, and this is known as the edible hibiscus, also called belay. They call it belay, and there's many varieties. This is just one of many. I have a friend who knows about many different types, and these are all over the world. And literally, this is going to grow into a tree. Basically, this is actually one plant that grows up into a couple different offshoots or upshoots. And this tree basically just has these leaves like this. And I always like to check my leaves for bugs. But you could just take these leaves and eat it. Now this leaf has a really nice mild flavor. It's not like a super strong, no medicinal flavor or anything like that. Really nice and mild. The really big leaves could be used for like something like wraps, or you could actually just break off pieces of leaf and make this into a salad. So if you're a student here, you know, I'd come every day and get some of these leaves as well as some of the other leaves that I'll show you guys in a minute. Make a nice big salad, and then maybe blend up a salad dressing and eat it for dinner. I mean, leafy greens, one of the most important foods you guys can be eating. And especially if you grow here, if you live here in South Florida, you should be growing one of these guys, because this will grow year round and you'll always have edible greens to eat. Another green you guys might wanna grow is this guy right here. It's known as the chaya tree. And this is a really popular edible leafy green. This one should be cooked, because it is can be toxic raw. So this is one for cooked greens, if you're gonna wanna cook your greens. But this grows really prolifically and could just be propagated by cuttings. Next, I wanna show you guys an even more valuable edible perennial tree that you guys can be growing besides the chaya. Let me see if I can find one around here. They're pretty much like scattered amongst the landscape. So probably my number one favorite tree to grow would be this guy. This is known as the moringa. And if you go to your local health food store, you can buy like powdered moringa leaves or powdered moringa powder. You know, they sell it for like maybe $40 a pound in some cases. But here in South Florida, you guys could just grow the moringa. And what I like to do is I like to just take the leaves and you can just eat them fresh and raw. That being said, the flavor on these, you know, can be a little bit strong, especially if you're not used to eating greens. Even a little bit like peppery or like a hot for some people's taste buds. So how I like to use these is actually just dehydrate it in the dehydrator, and then I just basically turn this into a powder, moringa powder, and then I'll add that to different things instead of just eating it straight, so I get the benefits of the moringa. You know, some people say that it's more nutritious than even kale, and we know how good kale is for you, right? And the moringa, it grows really well, and here's the thing. When your moringa gets too tall, don't be scared to just cut it off. I mean, this is a smaller tree here. They just cut it off, and then it'll actually create new shoots and grow up. You know, it also gets really tall, then just cut that back, and it'll just keep reshooting for you. And actually, that's how they traditionally harvest the moringa. They just let one upshoot grow, and they harvest it, then it gets too tall, then they just whack it down, then it just keeps growing upshoots so they can keep harvesting it relatively easy. I guess the next perennial green that's not quite a tree but a shrub I want to show you guys is katuk. So let me see if I could find one of those real quick. So one of my favorite tasting perennial greens for South Florida is this guy. It's actually known as katuk, and it's looked like they've actually come over here and topped them. So you could actually top them and take cuttings off this plant, which works really easily. I also like to use the tops and eat them, because they're a lot really tender greens. You could also eat the tips, which I really like. It's kind of, you could use it like instead of asparagus. It's really nice and tender. Let me see if I can find any here. They've done a good job at topping it so it doesn't get super tall. But even if you can't get the tops, you can just basically come here and strip the leaves back and take all the leaves off in one fall swoop, and this would be another excellent green to add into salads, but of course I just like to eat it raw. It kind of reminds me of eating like some snow peas crossed with some like nuts. It has like a nice nutty flavor. You know, I could just basically eat this stuff straight without a salad dressing. You know, although most people would probably like to eat it with a salad dressing. I mean, I just really find the intricate and unique flavors of all these different greens really cool. And I want to encourage you guys to like eat more simply, you know. We're used to all these complex flavors and mixing things in our daily lives. And, you know, why can't we just enjoy real food? Like, if we didn't have stores to buy all these prepared foods, you know, and we were just out of nature, we'd just be eating fairly simply. So another leafy green that's not quite a perennial, but will grow year round here, provided you give it a, you know, nice water and you don't get any freezes, is known as the Malabar spinach. They're growing the green variety here. And these are the nice succulent leaves right here. This has a more mild flavor, maybe a little bit stronger than the edible hibiscus. It's good. But what I like even more are the berries. And check this out. I mean, this plant is prolific with berries. Looks like it's doing very well here. Look at all these little berries here. So I have an episode where actually I juice these berries, and I really like these berries because they're really dark, deep, and rich pigmented with anthocyanins. And it's, and there's a bug on there. And it's these dark purple pigments may help you to help you lose weight and also provide your body the antioxidants it needs to quench all the free radicals. So essentially, this is an anti-aging food. So what I like to do is I like to carefully gnaw and get the juice out of the berries, but I like to spit out the seeds. Then after you do that, look, your tongue will be all purple. So this stuff could stain, but it all washes out. Especially if you get it on your fingers, it might take a while. But yeah, not only for the greens, but the edible berries. And also you could save the seeds in here. And I still might have some seeds available for this guy because I save and offer my seeds to you guys. So you want to check out the website, growingyourgreens.ecwid.com, for some of my very own Malabar spinach seeds that I'm offering. So now I want to show you guys another area that has some more greens growing. And I talked about this area earlier. This is the area with all the bananas. This is the lowest area that kind of all the water funnels to. So if you see below me, like the ground's really dark, and that's because it's absorbed all the water and whatnot. And over here is one of the greens that we want to talk about. It's the Thai pepper plant. And these leaves that are just really nice, they look almost like decorative. They're kind of like a little bit glossy and shiny. This thing is like totally taken over. It really likes when it's moist out. We could just pick a leaf here and I could eat it just fresh right off the plant. And it tastes kind of like black pepper, not like the hot cayenne pepper, but like black pepper. So this would be good to like, you know, break up and put in a salad for flavoring. So this would be another one of those greens that I would use in my salad if I was a student here, right? The greens here have a lot of different anti-cancer, anti-disease properties. And if you're a student here, you could just come and pick them for free. This would be way better than eating like an iceberg head of lettuce that like that's been shipped from California, was probably picked over 30 days ago. You could come here every day and pick your greens fresh. And also, you know, you'll probably be healthier because of it for sure. Especially after I show you the next two and the last two edible greens that they're growing here. So this is really like a food forest, man. There's like so many different things growing. Look, here's moringa that you guys learned about a little bit earlier above me. And there's like the bananas right here, and there's katuk here. This is a really great place. You could harvest a lot of stuff in one place. But what I want to show you guys about next is this one right here. This is known as the longevity spinach. And these are the leaves right here. And this is the plant, how it grows. Even in Las Vegas in 110 degree summers, this guy powers through no problem. You know, this plant does not like the cold. It's propagated just by simple cuttings. And I really like these leaves. It's known as Gynera procumbens or longevity spinach. And it's called longevity spinach probably for a really good reason, because traditionally this was used to increase your health and increase your longevity. And probably not many students here are eating the longevity spinach, aside from maybe some of the people that come regularly to the garden. I really like this because it's a really mild green, and this would also be going in my nightly salad if I was a student here. I guess the other crop that I would harvest, you know, maybe not as regularly, is another really medicinal edible green that there's a lot of new and emerging research coming out about. So let me go ahead and find that one and share with you guys that one next. So the next green that's growing is right here behind the bananas. And once again, you know, teaching you guys about microclimates. I mean, right above me, if you guys could see that, it's like I'm all shaded underneath the bananas, you know, here on the forest floor, literally. And so this is a really shaded place. This plant probably doesn't like too much sun. I mean, as you guys can see, it's just totally green and really nice dark green, actually, and thriving even in the shade. So, you know, you could grow always something in the shade. Some of these leafy greens that I talked about earlier, here's the pepper plant. But this one is known as an anemu. And this one, I like to just maybe grab some small leaves. This is a really, you know, more medicinal plant than like some leafy green that you'd eat regularly. So I like to just snack on this every once in a while. You know, this is a plant that I'm not super familiar with. I know about it. I've had it on several occasions. I still have yet to grow it. I think I actually got some seeds one of my last trips to South Florida. This is definitely one you will want to grow and look more into. I mean, it has a strong flavor, and I know a lot of you guys may not like it. I like my leafy greens no matter what they taste like, and I'm used to bitter foods. And I think, you know, we've lost the taste of bitters in our life because we eat all these, you know, sweet and sour and other flavored foods. But this one is just one I just want to share with you guys before I get into some of the more amazing fruit trees and more, you know, unique fruit trees that'll either grow well here or taste amazing. So one of the things I really like about this food forest is that it was established in 2010, and many of the fruit trees here were planted at that time. You know, the interesting thing I learned about on this trip here is that, you know, they planted different sizes of fruit trees in 2011 when this was started. You know, maybe 5 gallon, 7 gallon, 10 gallon. Then they tried to plant some 25 gallon fruit trees, which usually you would think, oh yeah, man, if you get a 25 gallon fruit tree, it's already fruiting, it's already more mature, and you're gonna get fruit sooner rather than later. But unfortunately, what they learned here is that many of the older fruit trees that were like in larger pot sizes actually didn't make it because maybe they were root bound and maybe, you know, they're a little bit older and they just were used to growing in the pot and they never broke out of growing in the pot even though they were planted in the ground. So they found that the younger trees in the smaller size pots actually over time did better than the large ones. Now this may not always be the case, but it's something to consider when you're buying fruit trees. So you might even be able to save some money and you know, have a more productive tree in the long run by buying a smaller tree. One of the trees that done really well as a category is the avocados. You guys can see this avocado tree. I don't know, what is that, like 30, 40 feet tall right there. It's now producing, and they have four different kinds or four varieties of avocados that produce in different months. So if you are gonna get multiples of one kind of tree, I encourage you guys to select ones that will fruit in different months so you don't get all your avocados all at once. So this will be spread out through the season. And once again, if you're a student here, man, during avocado season, you're set for guacamole. So another one of the fruit trees that I really want to share with you guys right here is the Barbados cherry. And before we look at the tree, actually, I want to show you guys this sign. I really like that they actually, you know, this is kind of like a botanical garden in the sense that, you know, most things, but not all, have a sign. And hopefully they'll get more signs coming up. And actually, even better is that, you know, many signs actually have a QR code, so you could actually scan that in your phone and get more information about the different, you know, foods they're growing here. So this tells you the family, the cultivar, the origin, you know, when it flowers, when it fruits, if fertilizing is necessary. But more importantly, I think the last line is most important to me. It's the cold tolerance. So this one is a cold tolerant down to 28 degrees. So even if they get, you know, a light frost or something, this guy is still gonna be standing, whereas maybe some of the more sensitive tropical fruits may not make it. And that's why this is in this part of the video, because I want you guys to grow the Barbados cherry and other Eugenia family fruit trees as one of your staple crops because it's going to be productive. Let's see if I could reach up in here and show you guys a fruit here. Now, I always want to encourage you guys to harvest the ripest fruit. This one's look kind of ripe and deep red from the bottom, but on the top, it's not so ripe. So another guaranteed place you could always get ripe fruit under one of these trees, generally, is underneath it. So if we look on the ground, we want to make sure there's no bug damage or any insect holes or anything before we eat it. But, you know, there are always generally some ripe fruit on the ground. You want to make sure it's not too squishy and not sitting down there and off the tree too long and fermenting. But look at the difference in the color between those guys, right? I want to always encourage you guys to harvest the fruit as ripe as possible. Number one, it's going to be sweeter. Number two, it's going to be more flavorful. Number three, you know, it's going to be more nutritious for you, full of more antioxidants. So we're going to go ahead and take a bite off this side that doesn't have any damage. That's definitely a good fruit there. Once again, this is more of a wild fruit versus a cultivated fruit. You know, it's not super sweet, but it has a nice flavor to it. You know, I think maybe juicing this with some sugarcane juice would be an excellent way to get some of the nutrition in you if you didn't like to eat these plain. But yeah, this tree thrives here in this environment. Definitely one to grow. Now this one is maybe not the best tasting one. I like it, but many of you guys might not. But the next tree I want to introduce you guys to, you know, this is one you absolutely have to grow, and it's absolutely the best fruit that I've had it on this whole trip to Florida this year. And it is the beauty berry. Just kidding. Actually, you guys should grow the beauty berry because of the deep purple berries. It's definitely not the best tasting fruit I've had, but it's another one that's going to grow really well, whether you're here in, South Florida, even, South Texas and other Gulf Coast states. The beauty berry is, you know, one of the more naturalized trees of the climates, and it's really rich. The Indians used to use it, you know, for beauty. I like to use the beauty berry, just come over and just take a whole bunch of the berries off the tree like that, and just make sure there's no bugs, and then pop them in your mouth. Now, once again, this is more of a wild fruit, and I really want to encourage you guys to eat more wild fruits. Having a food forest like this, you'll be able to do that. Eat beauty berries whenever you want for the purple antioxidants. All right, now for reals, I want to get to the fruit tree that I really liked the most. All right, so my favorite fruit of this whole trip to South Florida this time is this one. I never heard of this before, even on all my travels to Hawaii and Costa Rica and Puerto Rico and everywhere I went. This is known as the Jamaican, and that's probably why I haven't had it, because I haven't been in Jamaica. This is the Jamaican strawberry tree. And let's see, I don't see any like ripe fruits down low, so we're gonna climb it very carefully. Oh, here we go. That one's a really ripe fruit. Let's see if I can... All right, climbed up the tree, jumped out off of this one little berry that can change your life, seriously. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and eat this. Oh my God, when I eat it, I can't describe the flavor to you, I'm sorry. It tastes like nothing else I've ever eaten. It's like imagine a more fruity Starburst fruit chew with like a burst of flavor. I'm speechless, it's so good. You guys gotta grow it if you live in South Florida. I'll be your bestest friend when it's in season. Now the negative thing about this tree is that the birds, they also love the fruits, but the good thing is it looks like it's fairly prolific. You know, as I'm looking up on the tree, I see a lot of little, I see the flowers I've seen, and I've seen a lot of the green fruits just kind of hanging out, waiting to ripen up. Oh man, I wanna get that other one up there. These are so good. I wonder if I could shake the tree and some would drop. Give me your fruits! Give me your fruits! All right, none are dropping. It's not my lucky day. All right, so now I'm gonna walk through some other areas of the food forest here, and this is just a really nicely done food forest. I mean, there's mulberry as we pass by, and different kinds of crops growing. More katuk. I like that they have labels on a lot of different things and signage. Oh, and this is the Adamoya family. right here, nice huge tree. Let's see, I heard they had like only maybe a handful of fruits this year, and one of the workers here got most of the fruits off it. So yeah, it behooved you to, if you were into this stuff, is to get a job at the food forest. And they do take applications every year for some of the people that you'll get paid to work here to, you know, run volunteers to help, you know, trim and prune and do weeding and planting and starting and all this stuff. Be a great college education, on the job education. All right, so what I want to show you guys next is actually at the end over here. It's their special papaya planting, where they're growing smaller size fruits that are actually sweeter. You know, one of the main reasons why they grow papayas is because they grow year round. They use the green papayas, you know, to make papaya salads, of course. But some of the papayas may be affected with the fruit flies and other bugs when they get larger. So I think that's why they maybe like growing some of the smaller ones. So now I want to share with you guys this little papaya tree here. This papaya tree, they call it a candy papaya tree, because look at these fruits, like they're separated out like every, 8 inches, and they're just one fruit, whereas most papayas are like come in clusters at the top of the tree, which they do have some at the top also. But some of these guys are like super small, and they're ripe when they're really small like this. Check it out. This one's starting to turn yellow, and this is how big they get. I've never seen a little small papaya like this before. So these are definitely really good if you get a fruit fly problem. Or fruit fly gets this one, you just got a little small fruit, not like messing up one of those super huge big ones. So we're just gonna go ahead and let's see if we could break into this and show you guys what it looks like. Supposedly these are sweeter than the regular larger papayas. There's definitely not a lot of meat inside there to eat. Oh, and it's got a fruit fly inside there, so I'm not eating that one. All right, got another one. Good thing this one's riper. Maybe everything happens for a reason in my life. Yep, this one also has got some larvae in there too, man. Moving around. I'm not eating it. All right, got another one. This one's not as ripe either. Man, I don't even see any holes in here. I don't know how the fruit flies get in there. Man, there's another fruit fly worm in this one too. All right, so I guess it's a good idea to pick papayas green and make a papaya salad out of them. Yeah, papayas may be challenging. You got fruit flies, we gotta do some kind of control. All right, guess I'm not eating papayas today, but yeah, that sounded like a good idea, the small papayas. But I wanna show you guys this really fast before I go. This tree is not affected with fruit fly problems like the papayas, and look at this thing. This is loaded up. Unfortunately, I'm not here at the right time of year to enjoy these babies. This is one of my favorite fruits in the entire world. It's known as the Chico Sapote or Sapodilla. And they're the brown sugar fruit. They're so delicious. And if I was a student here, man, when these were ripe, man, I'd be eating like lunch here every day for sure. But yeah, this thing is loaded up. This is definitely one of the other fruit trees you will want to grow here in South Florida, along with the standard white sapote. They're gonna do also very well for you. I think the last thing I'd like to do in this episode today is actually interview the president of the student who's the president of the food forest group on campus. His name's Cameron. So actually, let's go ahead and interview him next. So now I'm here with Cameron Cole, and he's the president of the student-run organization for the food forest here at the university. And we're gonna go ahead and ask him some questions today. So Cameron, when was this food forest started, and why?
It started back in May 2011. It's coming up on 5 years old now. And it just got started by a whole bunch of really passionate students. It actually took them, like, you could say the food forest is actually well over 5 years old, because the idea for it just took like two years just to incubate. And then it took another year to get it like implemented. And then like now we finally have it. It was planted back in May, and we finally have what we have now. And it just started out as like a plain old dirt parking lot.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's cool. So do you know the founders' names? Like, I was in a fraternity when I was in college, and I remember our founders' names and all this kind of stuff, and I was actually the vice president back in the day. But
yeah, but I would say that one of the biggest people involved would be like Erica Klopf, Arlo Simons, Taylor, Scott Stimson. And those would be like the main guys, I would say, that like were the Food Forest founders.
That's awesome, man. I'm glad they're there doing the work, you know, back in the day to get this established. And I think, you know, if you're going to a college now or university, you know, start a gardening club, number one. Number two, you know, get some land from the university to do a project like this and get, absolutely, you know, the student, body and whatnot supported on your side. So, you know, as the president, you're a liaison between this organization and, you know, the university at large, university, and also the student organizations that actually fund you.
Yep.
Like, what would you say are some hints for people that are maybe going to a college that doesn't have one of these that wants to get it? Like, how would you say would be the best strategy to make something like this happen in this day and age?
I would say don't come in empty-handed. Like, have a plan of, like, what you want to do. And then give people like a what if scenario and just be like, okay, just think of all the benefits of like, what if we have like this growing instead of like, say, a building, you know? I mean, there's so many benefits to like knowing how to grow your food, and you just need to like know how to properly communicate that to the people that don't really seem to know the emphasis of like how it's so important to know how to grow your own food. And a lot of kids are out of touch with that, and the Food Forest is a great educational opportunity for not only college kids but for the community at large to come in and learn how their food is grown and maybe how some food they're not familiar with is grown. And it's just a great educational tool, and that's a good selling point, I think.
Yeah, no, I mean, I totally agree. I mean, this is just a great concept all around to get it in universities. I mean, I think even school age kids, you know, grade school and all this kind of stuff, middle school, high school, they should have gardens and farms. And I know some of the plants and the propagative material from trees and different, you know, starts that they do here are taken out to the local community so that, you know, they help plant school gardens.
Yeah.
So, Cameron, we were just talking about some of the benefits, but so what are some of the benefits to the Florida Gulf Coast University that you guys have an established food forest here?
Well, a lot of kids that don't have like proper access to like healthy veg can come out here and just chow down as much as they want because of all the perennial greens we have growing year round, as you've already pointed out in your video.
Right, yeah, you guys just learned about them.
Just being able to like learn about fruit that they're not familiar with. I love seeing people's eyes just open up, like when they're like, wait, that's a papaya tree? Like, that's where a papaya comes from? Like, wait, this is a guava tree? Like, there's such a thing as a peanut butter fruit?
Yeah.
You know? So it's like, I love seeing that aha moment, like when the kids are coming in and like just like really taking it all in, sucking it up, you know? And it's just it's what fuels me here. Yeah. And like as far as like a benefit, I mean, we produce about 5,000 pounds of food every year. So I would say that makes a significant difference on the hunger on campus. And hopefully we get people to actually grow their own food back at their homes. So maybe that's making another difference, like one step away from Big Ag, you know, and closer local agriculture. So it's always a good thing.
Cool, yeah, so helping out with the local student, the student population, teaching them where food comes from. I mean, another benefit to the university, of course, is to maintain their green image, which they like to have. I mean, this is probably one of the greenest things you guys could do, is to grow your own food. And I mean, I wish the food that was grown here in the Food Forest was, you know, better integrated into, you know, the school and served to the students at large. You know, the way it's used now is that students could come here and harvest stuff and eat it whenever they want. But unfortunately, you know, most students are not maybe told about this resource until their senior year, or maybe even taught about it on a school tour, you know, in their freshman year. So I think, you know, that could probably be improved here so that more people use this amazing resource that's right under their noses. And I mean, it makes me sad that most students don't come here. You know, as I've been here, I haven't seen any students aside from the student workers come into this food forest today. So Cameron, what's one way you think the students here at the school could better have access or know about this? Like, what's one thing you think administration could change, for example?
I mean, First thing would be like to have a proper orientation that includes the food forest. So as it stands right now, they educate the students as like how FGCU is green orientated and like all the fun things to do on campus, but yet they tend to leave out the FGCU food forest, which I believe is not only fun, educational, and green. It's just a fun little group of people that I've become really close with over the past couple years.
Yeah, I mean, create a community around the food forest, and like basically there's all kinds of different student groups, whether you're in a fraternity, sorority, or other student groups into playing chess. You know, I think the gardening and the permaculture club, probably one of the best, coolest people to hang out with personally.
Yeah, they're my family.
And also, you know, if the college introduced the students to this, you know, the students would know about that, hey, they have a food source if they're running low on money or whatever, just to come out to connect with nature, to connect with foods, or to connect and learn about new foods. Oh, Cameron, one of the things I want to ask you is about how is some of this food here being integrated into curriculum and teaching kids about, you know, how to prepare these foods and into chefing and all this kind of stuff?
Oh, well, we do actually have a club here on campus, which I run, and we have a little group called Meatless Monday. So we get all the food from the food forest, and we cook up little vegetarian meals from what we grow out here. And that's another little community building thing. And we also have the permaculture class here on campus, which is a nice little class that teaches you all about like how to grow this stuff, like what to do with it, where it comes from. And we strive to like let people know, because like a lot of this seems kind of intimidating to people who don't know, but all we need is just to like teach them, okay, this is a yucca, it's a root crop, you pull it out of the ground, you cook it like this, and it's a learn by doing thing.
Exactly.
Most of the time it's kind of hard to learn just from watching it on a YouTube video. Yeah. You know, it's so different from like getting your hands on and like peeling a yucca for the first time,
or digging it up and pulling it out of the ground. Yeah, and all that stuff.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah, and just it's so fun. And making like, I don't know, Thai green papaya salad is another popular one we have at Meatless Monday. And just like letting people know like how to do that. It's like, hey, come to our meetings on Thursday, and like the Facebook page and stuff like that. Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah, I mean, another benefit to the college is actually, you know, creating healthier students, right? Mm-hmm. By eating more, especially locally raised plant foods and greens and fruits that are produced on site that are high antioxidants, lower in calories than all the processed food they're probably serving in the cafeteria. You know, they're going to have healthier students, so that I think the health center or whatever, you know, that's close by could get less patients.
Absolutely.
And actually healthcare at large could be, you know, minimized if people ate healthy. So I think it's great that you're, you know, providing this service. So what would you say, Cameron, to students out there, maybe people looking for a school to go to, would you recommend this school to them, you know, if they want to learn more about permaculture and all this stuff? Because I know you transferred to this school from somewhere else.
I did. I came from State College of Florida to Florida Gulf Coast, and just their mission statement of like environmental sustainability like hit me hard. Like that's really what sold me to like come here. And then when I found out, like, oh my God, there's a big food forest here, like growing food in the model of like a forest system. And I was like, that just blew my mind. Mm. Like if you want to learn about sustainability, especially like agricultural sustainability, like FGCU is a good option, I would say. Yeah,
I think it's quite unfortunate that most, you know, universities may not teach about food forest systems, which is, you know, on the leading edge. I mean, I think commercial production in the future needs to go towards food forest systems, and there's many reasons why this is not done, including, you know, this can be more labor intensive to harvest everything, because it's not just monocrops where you just come in and harvest everything at once. I mean, this tree's ripe this day, that tree's ripe the other day, but it's, this is the best way to build the soil, you know, build up the humus in the soil, and just to grow things, you know, and have a diverse, you know, growing area. Oh, so I want to talk to you about that, Cameron. Like, how many different varieties and fruit trees are you guys growing here on the food forest?
We have over 80 varieties of fruits growing in the food forest right now. And we actually have a database on the FGCU website of, like, all the fruit that we have growing in the food forest. If you guys want to check that out, feel free to. So, yeah.
Well, now, besides just the fruit, which everybody likes fruit because it's always sweet, but what along with all the edible plants, so fruits, including other edible plants, including perennial greens, herbs, and all the different plants you guys have in here, do you have any ideas on how many?
Too many to count, but well over 100, I would say. Just in this half acre area of land, we have such a vast amount of biodiversity that, like, I just think that, yeah, we could pretty much feed a whole family on nothing but food for us here, yeah.
That's cool. So any other comments you'd like to share with my viewers today, whether they're a student or just somebody in the local area, about growing food, about food forests, about any of this stuff?
I would say just find a local garden, like grab some fruit trees and just put them in your backyard. Like that's step one, you know, you got to start somewhere. And this has really inspired me to like take this with me for the rest of my life. This has really changed my life for the better, I would say. Yeah. And just take that first step, get out there, grow your own fruit, grow your own veg, and it'll change your life.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely changed mine. I know a lot of you guys that have been watching me for a long time, I know it's changed your lives because you guys have implemented more fruits and vegetables in your diet and minimizing the process or even eliminating the processed foods, junk foods, you know, getting rid of the animal products completely or just reducing them, you know, to a, you know, really small level and eating more of the most nourishing foods on the planet, which are literally the fruits and the vegetables. Yeah. So Cameron, if somebody wants to learn more about the club here on campus or just the university, can you give them the websites and all this stuff?
Oh, absolutely. So if you want to follow us on Facebook, it's FGCU Food Forest, and just give us a like. We have a whole bunch of admins that'll probably approve you. We've already got around 2,000 members right
cool.
now, and we update like all of our posts like with when our meeting times are, what our events are gonna be. So a lot of the time we go to like, we go on field trips to like different like Naples Botanical Garden, or we'll go to like Pine Manor Gardens or stuff like that. And it's not only food for us, we're trying to promote permaculture in general as like a food production method, yeah. So yeah, just follow us on Facebook, and that's the best way to keep up.
Now, is this open for like students of the university or just anybody, wherever they live, or how does that work?
We're happily accepting anyone who wants to come by and learn about permaculture. We can give them a tour. We can give them something to eat, like just something to try. Like we always have papaya coming off of our trees, so we're more than happy to share.
Yeah, wonderful. Yeah, so this is a great resource if you guys live in the area. You want to stop by here and see what they've done. See what you could possibly do in your backyard, right? And you could try some. I tried a papaya. It was definitely a good papaya, one of the best I've had in Florida. And yeah, I definitely encourage you guys to come by. So what's the website for the university itself?
Just look up FGCU and then in the search bar type in Food Forest, and that'll actually take you to our database.
Yeah. Oh, okay, awesome, awesome. And if somebody wanted to learn about coming to the university,
just Google FGCU and then go into the admissions page.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I think that's the end of my questions for you, Cameron, today. Thanks for having me out, and thanks for showing me around and even being my cameraman part of the day. His name's Cam. Cameron. I definitely had a fun time here, and I want to encourage you guys to come for a visit. You know, email them, contact them. I'll put the link down below once again to contact them so you guys could come on a tour of yourself, this place personally, as much as this is a resource for, you know, the students here on the campus. It's also a resource for you guys that live in the local area. Even if you're just traveling through, you know, if they're doing tours on the day you're around, hey, you guys could go on a tour and learn about this place and try some fruits and try some, you know, perennial vegetables, maybe the ones that you learned about in this episode. I definitely had a fun time here, and I want to encourage other administrators and people working in universities and colleges to, you know, start a food forest or at least gardens in your college or university. And I do want to say this, I do like the concept of a food forest much better than just simply starting a raised bed garden or a garden. Yeah. Because here's the thing, even if all the people in charge of this walked away tomorrow and, you know, the weather continued to rain and all this kind of stuff, things would continue to grow. This system would be just keep going on its own without even any input, whereas annual beds, annual gardens got to keep being tended to. You got to keep harvesting, keep replanting, all this kind of stuff. So I think food forests, especially in the right climate, zone, and you could do food forest pretty much anywhere. You just gotta select different plants. You can't use some of the ones that I showed you guys today. It's totally possible and able, and I think, once again, food forests are the future. Food forests are the future. So if you guys enjoyed this episode, want me to come back to FGCU in the future, do more episodes, because I mean, there's so much stuff I didn't even cover today. I can't cover it all. Be sure to give me a thumbs up to let me know if I get a lot of thumbs up. I'll make a special trip, come back here and hang out with Cameron and all the amazing people and the students that I met today who showed me a great time, and make more videos for you guys to share with you guys about more about what they're doing here. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below. I have a few more videos coming out while I'm here in Southwest Florida to educate you guys about some other cool resources in the area, as well as other plants and things you could grow. And also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,200 episodes at this time, educating you guys on all aspects on how you guys could grow your own food at home, especially if you're living in South Florida. You know, do a search for South Florida videos. You'll find a whole bunch where I was actually on the other coast of Florida, which will also apply here on the West Coast in most instances. And also be sure to share this video with other college administrators or just people that live in the local area so you guys can see what is possible. And I think what the future of education needs to be relating to food is to educate the college students and get them more involved and even make mandatory courses in you know, learning to grow their food, because we're taught, like, you know, how to read, write, arithmetic and all of this kind of stuff and history, but we all need to eat every day. And at this time, you know, learning how to grow your own food is not a required course, and I think it is because we all need to eat, and this would make us more of an independent nation, and it would make us also more picky about the foods we're eating instead of just eating the crap and the junk foods and all this kind of stuff. So anyways, that's my rant, and with that, I gotta get going. And once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.
All right, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm here in my front yard garden, and it is now December time, and finally, I'm just pulling out my peppers and cucumbers, well, what's left of the cucumbers. I've already started pulling out the tomatoes.